start this morning off with a question. And I believe the answer to this question is yes, and if not, you've been living under a rock. So the question is, has life ever given you a surprise? I know for some of us, the answer to that is a very strong yes, especially this week. You know, and sometimes surprises can be really good. I remember one time when I was in high school, or actually as I was leaving high school and moving to college, my parents threw me a surprise going away party. And that was a good surprise. And I was so excited, it was all my friends were there. You couldn't tell I was happy because I was crying, but that's how my emotions come out. So I was, you know, that was a good surprise. But yesterday, I watched this guy go through a surprise that was not good. Let me tell you about this. So if you may remember, it's been quite a few weeks now, but the last time that I was up here preaching, I talked to you guys about something called the High Hopes course at Southern Wesleyan University, where Dylan and I went to school. So just a little recap, this High Hopes course is something when you are strapped into a harness and you are tied to a rope and you are either climbed or pulled up like, you know, 60, 70 feet in the air, and you have to complete like a series of obstacles. And so Southern Wesleyan has this, I guess you could call it a tradition now, it's the second year they've done it, but every freshman that comes into Southern Wesleyan goes through this High Hopes course. And so yesterday, Dylan and I were out there all day, and we were working with some of the incoming freshmen, and just, you know, when you start out the day, they're very nervous, they don't really know what to expect, they barely know each other, and so everyone is really quiet and withdrawn. So we kind of do some warm-up exercises just in the room, like inside, they're, you know, completely safe. Everything is in within their comfort zone. And then we take them outside, and we go to what we call the low ropes course, and we do some more exercises there. Again, the whole day is safe, but it's a little bit more out of some people's comfort zone, especially if they don't like bugs or they don't like dirt or being outside. And this one guy, I mean, you just have to feel sorry for him. He heard that we were going to the ropes course. He didn't hear us say low ropes course, he just heard ropes course. So we go out there and we're doing some challenges on the ground, which again, there are things that make you think you have to work together as a team. You could just tell, I've never met him before, but you could just tell he was one of those guys that likes to be the hero and be in control, and that was not where he was yesterday. So he was already out of his comfort zone, and he heard, okay, today you're going to be out of your comfort zone. So he was like, all right, this is it. This is the High Hopes course they were talking about, and we got through everything, and you could see his face, and he was like, okay, that wasn't a big deal. And then we said, okay, now it's time to go to the High Hopes course, and he said, what? And you could tell, like, the look on his face just went from happy, like, accomplished, to terrified. And you could tell that he had just had a bad surprise thrown at him. And if you have ever felt that feeling of what is going on, then you know what I'm talking about. And we're starting this new series today. We're calling it Life is Good. But not life is good, we're calling it life is good, because as you can see, as you know, sometimes life is good, sometimes we feel like we are on top of the world, and sometimes life is not good. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, then again, you've got to be living under a rock, because we've all been there, we've all been in those places when the words life is good just seem like a mockery. But the thing is, when we're on top of the world, when we are feeling like nothing can stop us, when we have everything going the way that it feels like it should be going, we kind of forget sometimes that life can also throw us some curveballs. And when those times happen, when we go from being on the top of the world to feeling accomplished, to feeling like, okay, I got out of my comfort zone, but I did it anyway, and then having this huge curveball, you know, a lot of times it's much bigger than just finding out you're going on a High Hopes course. We just feel completely blindsided. And so the series that we're going to be going through over the next few weeks is going to be looking at the life of Job. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with Job, he is a guy that is often characterized as the epitome of suffering. He had it rough, let me tell you. And so if you have your Bibles with you this morning, I'm going to encourage you to go ahead and turn to the book of Job. We're just going to be starting in chapter 1 today. Just a side note about bringing your Bibles. I'm really going to encourage you guys to bring your Bibles over the next couple of weeks because Job is 42 chapters long, and we're going to try to cover the entire book in 5 weeks. And so just for the sake of time, we're not going to read every word of every chapter here during Sunday mornings. So two reasons that you should bring your Bibles with you. Number one is, I know sometimes when preachers talk for a long time, you get bored. So when you get bored, instead of just spacing off, you can just read the parts that we're skipping over. So that's the first reason you should bring your Bible to church, which you always should, because you always then have an excuse to not pay attention. But the second reason is so that you can kind of see where we are, so that you can go home and reread where we've been and kind of let the words soak in a little bit deeper, and also maybe read ahead, because there's a lot to unpack in this book, and we're going to be doing a very airplane view survey of this book. So throughout these next few weeks, if you don't already have a reading plan, I would just encourage you to read through the book of Job with us. So again, if you haven't already turned there, if you're having trouble, just turn to the book of Psalms, just open your Bible up to the middle, flip to the right a little bit, and you should be in the book of Job. So one of the things that I love about this book is that it kind of reads like a play. Like, you have your characters, you have a scene, you have settings, you have a plot, you have dialogue, you have all of these different components. You even have a narrator that bring this book together to really make it feel like a play. And in fact, there have been a lot of plays written about this book. So if you will, kind of pretend with me that this is a play that we're reading. And so we're starting with Act 1, Scene 1, which is just going to be Job 1:1. So imagine that the curtain is lifting on this play. You're in the audience, the lights have dimmed, and the narrator begins talking in Job 1:1, and he says, "In the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil." And so right from the very beginning, the first thing we learn about Job is where he's from, his name, and that he was blameless and upright, that he feared God and shunned evil. And I just want to take a few minutes and park on that statement, because that is so important to the book of Job, and it's important to our understanding of suffering. That Job was blameless. Because so often we as humans, when we see suffering or when we see something that we don't understand, we have to create an answer. And sometimes we create an answer that isn't always biblical. And so when we see people suffering or when we see them in pain, our first reaction, just because we have to make it make sense, is that, well, they must have done something to deserve that. You know, maybe it's a direct correlation. You know, maybe like, well, they got drunk and they drove anyway, so it's their fault that they got in that accident. I'm not saying that all car accidents are because of drunk drivers, but you know, like when we see something like that, we force blame on something. But other times, you know, and in that situation, it kind of makes sense. Like, at least you can point to the cause and you can see the effect, and so we feel good about that. We feel good that we could come up with an answer. But sometimes we see the suffering that our country has gone through these past few weeks with the flooding and the hurricanes, and we just think those people must have done something to deserve what they're going through, because our brain just doesn't do well with unsolved questions. And so I just want to say this morning that not all suffering is a direct cause of a person's sin. And again, this is pointed out so clearly when it says that this man was blameless and upright. And so before we even really get much further, let's all just promise this morning to stop trying to cast blame where blame doesn't need to be cast. Because when someone is hurting and when someone is in pain, the last thing that they need is for us to tell them, I told you so, or you deserved this, or you brought this on yourself. And later on in the book of Job, we're going to see that Job's three best friends do exactly that. And he goes from suffering to just anger, and he puts walls up and he stops listening to them because all they're doing is just telling him that you were wrong. So let's just stop with the blame casting. I'm not saying that we all cast blame, but it is in our nature. And so just let the Holy Spirit work on that in each one of us today. But then that also brings the question, if suffering doesn't come because of one person's sin, if it's not a direct result of sin, if it's not a punishment, where does suffering come from? And this is something that Christians, that humanity has struggled with for thousands of years. I mean, from the very beginning of time, we've been wondering, why do we have pain? And in fact, there was an ancient Greek philosopher who coined this so well. His name was Epicurus. And he said this, and it's going to be on the screen. Is God willing to prevent evil, but not able? Then he is not omnipotent. He is not all-powerful. Is he able, but not willing? Then he is malevolent. He is evil. Is he both able and willing? Then where does evil come from? And we kind of played with that a little bit to modernize it. Is he neither able nor willing? Then why should we call him God? And those questions, when you read them at first, you're like, yeah, I mean, I guess that kind of makes sense. Like, why, if God is all powerful and he is all good, how could he allow humanity to suffer? And that question right there, how does humanity suffer under a good, powerful God, is the answer to this entire series of philosophy called theodicy. And so theodicy is just trying to figure out where evil and pain and suffering comes from. And so the book of Job is a theodicy. It's a very in-depth study of the book of pain. And so over the next 5 weeks, we're going to be really honest with the question of pain, and we're going to get really deep into why suffering happens and our response to it and how God could allow it to happen. And so I just want to let those questions simmer in your mind for a few minutes, kind of wrestle with it, because here at LWC, we're not comfortable with just giving the good answer, like, well, we just need to trust God. You know, that's an easy answer, but it's not in depth, and it doesn't satisfy our deepest questions. So we're going to kind of come back to this. You know, how could a good God let bad things happen? But until then, we're going to move on. This is going to be another part that I'm not going to read. We're just going to skim over. But chapter 1 continues to go on, and it describes Job's wealth and his family. And it describes Job as having thousands of animals and many, many servants. And he is literally called the greatest man in the East. And so Job is on top of the world. And not only is he wealthy beyond all imagination, I mean, if he were alive today, he would rival Bill Gates in terms of wealth. And so not only is he on top of the world, but he has a very healthy family. The Bible says that he has 7 sons and 3 daughters, and his 7 sons will host each other for feasts on a regular basis. I mean, what parent doesn't want their kids to grow up and still be so close to one another that they have each other over for dinner on a regular basis? So you know that Job was a very loving father who taught his parent or his children how to love one another. And so it's not that, you know, well, Job is wealthy, but he doesn't know how to interact with people. Like, Job has it all. He's on top of the world. Nothing looks bad. There's no clouds on his horizon. But when we think about Job, we don't think about happiness. We don't think about a man whom God blessed. We think about suffering. And we think about, you know, maybe we think about his perseverance through suffering. A lot of times people refer to the patience of Job. But we don't think about his thousands of animals and his big old happy family. We think about pain. And so what happened? What caused Job to go from being on the top of the world to the pit of despair? And that is when Act 1, Scene 1 closes. And so then we get to Scene 2, and the curtains rise again. And in Job 1:6, we read this. One day, the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" And Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." How would you like to have the God of the universe describe you in that way? "Does Job fear God for nothing?" Satan replied. "Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands, so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But now stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Very well then, everything he has is in your power, but on the man himself do not lay a finger." And then Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. And now for a lot of reasons, that's a very deep passage of scripture that's a lot to unpack. You know, like, why were Satan and God talking? Do they do that often? Is this kind of a metaphor? There's a lot of different theories on what exactly these verses mean. And we're not going to get into all of that. But the important thing this morning is to note that God is so confident in the character of Job that he brought him to the attention of Satan. And he said, you know, I want you to look at Job. I want you to see what a man who follows me looks like. And that's him right there. And you can tell that God was so proud of him. You know, he was like a proud father who was looking down, and in all the earth he sees this man Job, whom he's blessed and whom Job has just returned every blessing that he's given. He's been faithful to sacrifice and praise God in every situation. And so God is confident in the character of Job. And that is just so challenging to me. That is really convicting, because it makes me think, you know, like, I mean, sure, I'm not the wealthiest woman in the world by far. You know, I don't have 10 kids. I'm not in the same situation as Job. But the question remains, when God looks at me, I mean, I know he's proud of me because God is proud of his creation. But does he look at me and is he confident in my character? Does he look at me and does he know that when I face rough situations, I will face them with integrity, the way that he knows Job will? And how does he know that Job will do this? How is he so confident in the character of Job? Simply because he has already seen Job's integrity day after day. It says earlier, we skipped over this part, but it says earlier that Job would often make sacrifices, not only for himself, but for his children also, because Job was so dedicated to the Lord that he wanted to make sure there was nothing in the way. And so God was confident in the integrity of Job. And so the challenge for us this morning from that is a simple question. Are we known in heaven as having integrity? Or are we known for turning to worldly measures when we're in times of distress? When we face adversity, do we turn first to God, or do we turn to our friends or to a substance, or, I mean, not even a bad thing, but do we just turn to one another instead of to God first? And so that's the question that I just really want us to think about this morning. How are you known in heaven? And don't hear me say that if you're known for turning to worldly measures, if you don't always turn to God first, that God isn't as proud of you, or he doesn't love you as much, because we already know that God can't do anything. We can't do anything to make God love us less. So it's not about that. But it is a question of, if we know that God loves us, and if we love him as much as he loves us, don't we want to be known for turning to him in times of distress? Because the Bible says that out of the overflow of our hearts, our mouth speaks. And so when bad things happen, is the overflow of our heart love for God when we're in distress, when we're in challenging situations? And so I like to refer to this scene too, this passage that we just read, as the scene where the main characters enter into the story of Job. Now you may be thinking, like, well, Job was introduced in the very first verse. Isn't Job the main character? I mean, he's the one that this whole book is named after. But the reality is, this story isn't really about Job. This story is about God and God's character, just like every single story in the Bible, even the story of our own lives, are about God's character. And so this brings us back to that question of theodicy, that question of where bad things come from. Is God able to prevent evil but not willing? Is he willing but not able? That's the question that we have to deal with this morning. And so there are just a couple of things to keep in mind as we're thinking about that. And the first one is, we don't know the mind of God. And any time that we talk about these things where we're trying to figure out, you know, like, was God right to do that? Those questions put us in the judgment seat. And we know, first of all, the Bible says not to put the name of the Lord to the test. But more deeply than that, when you hear an argument or a debate and someone is saying, like, well, I don't see how that's right, what they're saying is, I am in the place of judgment. I am the one who gets to determine morality. And in my view of morality, that's wrong. And automatically you can tell that that's just a logical flaw, because if you're the one who's determining morality, then that makes you God, because God's the one who determines morality. So let's not put ourselves in the judgment seat. Let's not make ourselves the one who gets to determine what's right and what's wrong. So that's the first thing to think about as we're thinking about this question of where evil comes from. And the second thing is, a lot of times people say, like, well, why didn't God prevent that? I mean, even, again, just with these hurricanes and with all of the stress that our nation's been going through and all of the stress that you on a personal level have been experiencing, it's so easy to say, like, why didn't God prevent that evil from happening? Why didn't he step down and intervene on my behalf or on our behalf? And the reality is, God prevents evil every single day that we have no idea about. And the reason we don't know about it is because God prevented it. And so, you know, sometimes we can see a glimpse. Sometimes we can hear the words from doctors that say they only have a month to live, and then they end up dying at a healthy older age. And sometimes we can see, you know, like, God prevented that evil from happening. But every single day, God prevents us from getting in accidents. God prevents us from getting sick. He is the only reason that we are here. He is sustaining us every day. And so every day, God is preventing evil. So we can't say that God doesn't prevent evil, because we know that he does. But the biggest reason that we experience suffering is our sin. And now, I know I said earlier that we need to stop casting blame on people who are suffering, But this is a little bit different, because not every pain is a direct result of sin, like I said earlier. Now, some are, like let's say that a teen disobeys her parents and goes to a party that she wasn't supposed to go to, and she gets in with a bad group of friends there. She, you know, maybe drinks to the point of getting drunk, and she decides to call her to drive home because she can't have her parents come pick her up. And on her way home, she gets really sick and she has to pull over, and maybe she even passes out. You know, someone has to call 911, and she goes to the hospital and has to get her stomach pumped. And now that suffering, we can see that that's a result of two sins. The first is disobeying her parents because she wasn't supposed to be there anyway. And the second is getting drunk and driving, because that's also a bad idea. And so we can see that some suffering is a direct result of someone's sin, but some isn't, like when natural disasters hit. Those natural disasters do not come from someone creating a hurricane. You know, those natural disasters don't seem like they're a direct result of sin, and they're not. They're not God's punishment on the unrighteous or anything like that, because righteous people were hit by that hurricane too. And so, and even in the book of Job, we've already established that Job is blameless, yet we know, because we know the story, that Job suffers way more than any human should. And so this brings us to the real question of this morning, or to the answer to our question of where pain comes from. And the answer to that question, as difficult as it sounds and as ludicrous as it sounds, is simply love. And now, when you hear that, that seems a little far-fetched, but let me explain myself. God is love. We know that because the Bible clearly states God is love. And because God is love, the biggest attribute of his character is love. And so love always wants the beloved to return that love, right? And so when God created us, he wanted us to love him. But you can't love something unless you have a choice to. Like, no one can force me to love Dylan. I love him because I choose to. I mean, there's a lot of things about him that I love that help me love him, but the reality is there are some days that it's a choice that I make to love him. And I know he would say the same for me. He's giving me hurt look right now. I'm sorry, babe. But, you know, love is a choice. You can't make someone choose to love you. And I know I can't make Dylan love me. He has to choose to love me. And the same goes for us and God. And so God gave us this thing called free will. And this is just the choice. He gave us a choice to either return the love that he gives us or to not return it. And of course, when we love him and we return that love, we're in his will. But sometimes we don't always return that love. And in fact, the very two humans to ever be given the choice of free will, immediately, as soon as they had a choice, they chose the wrong one. And if you're familiar at all with the story of Adam and Eve in the garden, you know that they were given a choice. Eve was told, even before Satan tempted her with that fruit, she was told not to eat of that fruit. So she knew she was doing wrong, and she knowingly sinned against God, went against his will. And in that moment, when she picked the fruit and she took a bite out of it and was opened up to the knowledge of good and evil, in that moment, sin entered the world. And we call that moment the fall of humanity. And that sounds really drastic until you think about the consequences of it. Because now Romans tells us that creation is groaning as in the pains of childbirth. And I've never given birth, but I've seen people who have. And let me tell you, it looks painful. I'm considering adoption just because of it. And so if you've never heard someone in the groaning and the pains of childhood, just trust me that it looks painful. And that is what creation is doing. And so these natural disasters that we face every day, and the things that seem like we didn't do anything to deserve them, when we feel blameless but we're suffering anyway, even cancer, even things that affect our bodies, like car wrecks and injuries and things like that, they're all a result of this one moment when sin entered the world. And the Bible tells us not to give Satan a foothold. And what happened in that moment is that Satan got a foothold in our world, and look what he's done to it. Just that one foothold allowed him all of the pain throughout all of history. And so, it's so hard to wrestle with this, because we want to look at suffering and we want to say, like, why? Why doesn't God just stop this? But we can't, but he doesn't stop it, because to stop it would be to completely remove sin. And it would be to completely remove the option for sin. And in that moment, if he were to completely remove it, then he would remove our free will. He would remove our ability to willingly love him. And so that, as difficult as it is, that's where love, that's where suffering comes from. It's just God's desire for us to love him. And not just because he's egotistic and he needs glory, but because that's what we were created to do. And he knows that when we're not loving him, when we're not worshiping him to the best of our ability in every moment of every day, we're not fully happy. And so it's not because he just wants the best for himself, but it's because he wants the best for us, because he knows that the best for us is to be in worship at all times. And so that answer to the question of where suffering comes from is love, as twisted as it sounds up front. And so that brings us to Act 1, Scene 3. And I would title this scene, if I were the playwright, I would just call it Job Loses It. Because in this chapter, Job loses everything. And it starts out, I'm sorry, we're not in Chapter 3 yet, we're in Scene 3, we're still in Chapter 1 and 2. But this scene starts out with Job, as he is just out in his field one day, he sees a messenger running to him at full speed. And he sees a look of concern on his face, and he maybe has a little bit of an idea that something bad is coming, but no idea what's about to hit him. And so this messenger runs up to him, he's probably out of breath and panting, and he says, Master, I was out in the field just now and I was working, and there's a group of Sabians, our worst enemy, and they came and they killed every one of your oxen and every one of your donkeys and every servant. And I barely escaped with my life, but I just came because you needed to know that you've lost a third of your wealth just now. And while that messenger was still speaking, from another direction, Job sees another messenger running towards him. The same thing, same concerned look, same out of breath, flushed face. And he says, Master, I was in that field over there. And you know the Chaldeans, the Babylonians, you know how we don't really get along? Well, they just came and they killed every single one of your camels and every servant that was out with your camels. And another third of your wealth was gone. And then another servant comes, and at this point Job is like, no more. But this servant comes and he runs toward him and he says, Master, I was just out with your sheep. You know, it's shearing time, you were getting ready to shear all the flock of your sheep. And all of a sudden, as all of the sheep and all of the servants were together in a field, fire from heaven fell and wiped out everything. And I don't know why, but I'm the only one that escaped, and I'm here to tell you that a third of your wealth is gone. And if you can do math at all, you know that one third plus one third plus one third equals everything. And so here, in the space of probably just a couple of minutes, maybe an hour, Job has lost not only his current wealth, not only his bank account, but his source of potential future wealth. It's like he lost his job, his investments, his savings, and his retirement fund, all in the space of an hour. And so it's not like he has anything to fall back on. And so maybe he's thinking, well, you know, I have 10 kids, they're all grown up, they all love me. I'll probably just go live with one of them until I get my feet back together and I can work everything out. And then Job sees a fourth messenger. And if you think Job's having a bad day, just wait, because I know, I can just tell that Job is like, no more. Like, he sees the look on his face, it's the same as the other three. And he says, no more, I can't handle any more news today. And the messenger says, no, no, Job, you need to hear this. I was just serving one of your children as they were all together in the same house having a feast. And a strong wind, kind of like a tornado, came through and blew the house down. And every single person in that house died, except for me. And so in this moment, Job has lost everything. He's lost his children, whom he loved. He lost his wealth. He has nothing left. And this next verse is probably one of the most convicting verses in Scripture. And this is verse 120. And now what we want this verse to say is that Job left his servants, and he went away by himself, and he cried out to God, and he was angry, and he yelled at God and said, God, you did this, why? That's what we wanted to say, because that would make us feel better, right? Because that's our first reaction when suffering comes. That's what we want to do. But instead of doing that, Job does this. It says, at this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head. Okay, he's mourning, he's getting angry. And then he fell to the ground in worship. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. And in all this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. What a response to suffering, that in his darkest moment yet, the very first thing he does is fall to the ground and worship. How convicting is that to you and to me? When trouble comes our way, is that our response? And the thing is, this reaction, this act of faith, did not happen in this moment of crisis. His faith was not built right then. But this is simply the effect of the cause of him day after day, year after year, turning to God in every situation. And so my challenge to you this morning is, if you are not in a place of suffering, if you haven't related to anything that we're talking about, if you're on the top of the world this morning, let me just tell you, life is not always roses and unicorns and rainbows. And there will be times when your faith is tested. And so you can prepare for those times right now by every day, in every situation, turning to God in worship. And if you're in the same place as Job this morning, you know what it's like to feel pain. You know what it's like to not know what's coming next and to be scared and terrified and weeping and in pain. And so if you're in that place today, I challenge you to worship God anyway. Because God is still good and he still deserves our worship. And then if Job's wealth and his children weren't enough, Satan then goes to God and he asks permission, which I think is important. Because we need to remember that Satan is not in control, even though it looks like it, and even though he hurts us, he's not in control. So Satan has to go to God to ask for permission to hurt Job more. And God, in his infinite knowledge and knowing way more than we do, allows it. And so Satan attacks Job with painful sores. He attacks his health. In fact, these sores are so painful that Job, all he can do, his only response, can be to just take a piece of broken pottery and scrape at them. Because they itch so bad and they're so painful that all he can do is just sit there and scratch. But we know that Job is still praising God, because in Job 2:9, His wife says to him, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." And that's the only two sentences that we hear from Job's wife in the entire Bible. And that is the legacy that she left for us. Curse God and die. That's all she says. But we have to keep in mind that his wife was experiencing the same pain he was. She may not have been in physical pain, but Job's wealth would have been her wealth too, and his children were her children. And so she was suffering, and her response to suffering was to curse God, to be angry at him, to cry out from him, to run against him, and to try to get Job to do the same. And you see, we don't have any record of Job's wife participating in the sacrifice. We don't have any record of her worshiping daily as we do Job. And so maybe she reacts like this because she didn't have the same foundation that Job did. And so our challenge this morning is, even though it can be so easy to respond like his wife, we need to be building our foundation of trust and faith so that when trial comes, or when you're in the middle of trial, or when you see a friend in trial, the very first thing we do is to praise God anyway. And if you're there this morning, if you feel like you've lost everything, like you've lost control, and you need some hope, let me read to you some verses from 1 Corinthians 15. Because 1 Corinthians is in the New Testament. And what we wish that we could go tell Job, who's in the Old Testament, who lived before the time of Jesus, who lived even before the time of the Israelites. So he had no idea that there was going to be a Savior coming who was going to change everything. He was going to defeat the adversary who had destroyed him. So he really had no hope other than just his relationship with God. But we do, because we're living on the other side of the cross. And so this morning I want to read to you from 1 Corinthians 15:55. And it says this, "Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because that you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." And so Job didn't know Jesus. He didn't have the same advantage that we have. But what a beautiful thing this morning to know that Jesus is victorious in every situation. And Jesus has won the victory. And the reason it doesn't feel like that, the reason that sometimes the pain of evil in this world can feel overwhelming, is because Satan knows that too. He knows that Jesus has already won. He knows that his time is limited. So he's going to make the best use of the time that he has. Or I should say the worst use, because he is going to use the time that he has to try to get you to deny Jesus. But the reality is, Jesus has already won. So when trial comes, just let Jesus have the victory, because he already does. And so we have a choice this morning. When trials come and we're faced with adversary, are we going to respond like Job, who turned to God in worship? Or are we going to respond like his wife, whose reaction was to curse God and want to die? And so this morning, as you're thinking about that question, I just want you to keep in mind one thing, that Jesus has already won, and Satan just isn't willing to admit it yet.